हरे हरे राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। I'm being heard, right? Saragrai Prabhu?
Yes, Babuji, in between it was little broken, but it is fine now.
Yeah, I didn't use my mobile internet today whole day, so I hope I will have sufficient. Okay, and yeah, you're recording. Okay, fine. Yeah. Okay, Hare Krishna. So welcome everyone. So just to briefly look at the theme that we did last time, because what we're discussing today is in a sense continuation of that. So if you remember, we had started our discussion on Ishvara, where we spoke of, two things I spoke last time. One is there is a lot of emphasis in the Gita about the Brahman platform, where you see a non-duality with things, with people, and so on, and the importance of that. So that was one thing that we discussed last time. We essentially said that with that, basically, it is only this philosophy that actually helps a person. And if you see in Gita also 4.36, if you remember, we quoted where Krishna says that anyone who is on the boat of transcendental knowledge, he can easily cross over nirvana and so on. So we are never shy in discussing, debating, etc., because that is how the Shastra presents. And then the last point that we saw was the difference between avatar and Bhagavan, where we said that Bhagavan is, the difference is that avatar means when Lord comes to this world, he behaves almost like a human being. Like we see in Ramayana also, Lord Ram tells all the devatas before he comes that they should never kind of do anything that indicates that he's God. So basically, he wanted to live just like a human being. So that is why an avatar, when he comes to this world, he exhibits limitations several times, right? So Krishna also, at times he says, I was over there, so I could not be here, and so on. But sometimes they are like Bhagavan also. That means they violate something. So like we discussed how Krishna saved Parikshit, but did not save Abhimanyu or whatever, right? So we discussed all this last time. So this was the theme that we discussed last time. Okay, good. So today we are continuing with the theme of Ishvara, and our main discussion is from the 9th chapter Bhagavad Gita. There are several verses from the 9th chapter Bhagavad Gita that we will be looking at today. And it will be a continuation of what we spoke last time. And also it would be in a continuation of almost everything that we spoke even before that. Right, so these are some of the verses of Bhagavad Gita that we will be referring today, primarily from 9.4 onwards till 9.29. So there are several verses that we are going to talk about. Okay, good. So let's start with whatever questions that we are going to discuss today. The apparent contradiction between 9.4, 6.30 Bhagavad Gita. The second thing is about how does Krishna also do Nishkama Karma Yoga? So that is the second thing, which we will again see from 9th chapter only. Yeah, so I was saying that these are the topics that we are looking at. All are from the 9th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. So we'll start right away with the first one. Okay, so the first one that we are looking at today is, so if you remember last time we spoke about how in the first 6 chapters of Bhagavad Gita, there are so many places where Krishna is emphasizing or he's talking about a Brahman realized soul. He's talking about how one sees that non-duality in things and in people around in the world. So there is a final verse that we had to see from Bhagavad Gita on that. So that was 7.29. Jara marana mokshaya mama shritya ते ब्रह्म तद् विदु कृत्स्नम् आध्यात्मम् कर्म चाकिलम्. Krishna is saying, intelligent persons who are endeavoring for liberation from old age and death take refuge in me in devotional service. They are actually Brahman because they entirely know everything about transcendental activities. So in this verse, if you see, Krishna is talking about how they are actually Brahman. Te Brahma Tat Vidu Kritsnam. And Prabhupada also in his purport, he says that such people have no misgivings about Krishna, and thus they are factually Brahman. So there are such verses also in the Gita that talk about the Brahman understanding, and those who are in that understanding, what they get, right? Like the 7.29. Okay, now we are going ahead with the 9th chapter today, and in the 9th chapter, one of the first verses that comes up, which is a very famous verse as well and often quoted, is 9.4 and 9.5, where Krishna talks about maya tadam idam sarvam jagadavyakta murtina matstani sarvabhutani nachaham te shomastitah, where Krishna is saying that by me in my unmanifested form the entire universe is pervaded, all things are in me but I am not in them. Right, and then Krishna in 9.5, Nachamatstani Bhutani, he says, everything that is created does not rest in me. Although I am the maintainer of living entities, I am not a part of this cosmic manifestation. Right, so Krishna is saying like this in 9.4 and 9.5. So now what we are raising first is, we had read last time, if you remember, in 6.30 Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna is saying, Yomam Pashyati Sarvatra Sarvam Chamai Pashyati, that one who sees everything in me and me in everything. Right? So we saw that verse, and we also saw how in 7th chapter and even 10th chapter Bhagavad Gita, Krishna talks about seeing himself in everything in the universe. And now in this verses in 9.4 and 9.5, Krishna is saying that I am not in any of this. So apparently it seems contradictory, because in one place he is saying that you should see me everywhere, and in another place he is saying that I am not in all of this. So when he says like this, right, it seems apparently contradictory. So how do we resolve that? So we resolve that by understanding that in this particular verse, in 9.4 and 9.5, Krishna is speaking about the Purusha Rupa. So that means, that means he is saying that he himself as a Purusha, he is not there in everything, right? So just like somebody may say Mother Guru itself is God. So there is one thing to say Matra Devo Bhava, and there is another thing to say that this is only God. No, there is nothing beyond this, right? So so the idea is 6.30 Bhagavad Gita, 7th chapter, 10th chapter Bhagavad Gita is teaching us that as Shakti, we can see Bhagavan everywhere, but at the same time, 9.4 Bhagavad Gita is reminding us that we can't call everybody Bhagavan, right? So that Achintya Veda Veda is there. That means all these things around us in this world, in that Krishna is there, but at the same time, he is not there also, because he has his own separate identity as a Purusha. Correct. So there is a subtle difference, and that is how we understand the distinction between 6.30 and 9.4. There is, of course, an interesting set of verses in Vishnu Puran that would help one understand this better. You know, Vishnu Puran basically says that all those who are Purusha Vachak, they represent Narayan, and those who are Stri Vachak, they are representing Lakshmi. So just like, for example, in normal Hindu culture also, sometimes people will say that when a daughter-in-law comes home, they say, Ghar mein Lakshmi aayi. So the wife is considered Lakshmi, but it doesn't mean that she is actually Lakshmi. What it means is she represents the qualities of Lakshmi. I mean, if you are willing to see it that way, if you are conscious of the qualities of God, then she will remind you of Lakshmi, right? Because she will have all those qualities that Krishna speaks of, for example, in 10.34 Bhagavad Gita, about fine speech and intelligence and everything. So like that. So that means the idea is anything can give us an understanding of God, and 6th and 10th chapter is talking about representation. That 10th chapter is talking about how everything can give us an idea of God, but at the same time 9th chapter is reminding us that no, as a Purusha he stays separate. So this is the first theme that right we are seeing for the day. Moving ahead, the next thing from the ninth chapter, if you go to the next verse, it is extremely interesting. Now we are talking about how Krishna does a perfect Nishkama Karma Yoga. That's very interesting. 9.6, if you see, Krishna says, Yata akasha stito nityam vayu sarvatra go mahan tata sarvani bhutani matsta nityupadharaya. Krishna is saying that understand as the mighty wind blowing everywhere rests always in the sky, all created beings are rest in me. So basically, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, he says that in commentary for this verse, 9.6, he says, generally, when we are part of any creation, we get attached to it, right? So just like somebody gives birth to a child, or we create a company, business, or someone educates some student, then we become attached to that. But Krishna has made such a huge creation, but he's not attached to it, correct? So in this entire series of verses in Bhagavad Gita, from 9.6 to 9.10, he makes it very clear that he's detached from everything. If you see 9.9, he again says, Udasina Vadasina, I am detached from all material activities. So basically what we understand is that Krishna has made this huge prakriti, but he's detached from it. It's actually the perfection of Nishkama Karma Yoga, where somebody creates something, but he is not attached to that. And it is actually very difficult. It is not that easy. But Krishna is setting the topmost example of how someone does that type of Nishkama Karma Yoga. So just like we also know that even in modern times, sometimes someone resigns from a company, but they keep controlling that company. So if we have read about the Tata Group, we know that some years back, Ratan Tata resigned as chairman. And he got someone else's, some relative, nephew or somebody. But then it is said he was always controlling externally, emotionally. He was controlling that whole group and finally again came back. So many times we see that Infosys also, Narayan Murthy. Many times we see this in this world, that people, when they create something, they give it to somebody else, but they are not ready to completely give it also. Right? Or just like in every home, a mother-in-law, you know, the daughter-in-law comes, she doesn't want to give her son completely to her. She also wants to give controlling. So basically, Nishkama Karma Yoga means you have a creation, but at the same time, you know that now that creation is there. So you kind of be detached from that creation. So just like we see Krishna in the battlefield of Kurukshetra also, that Pandavas won the war, but after the war, he just left and went away, right? And his whole creation was destroyed. If you see in front of Krishna, only all his sons died. Pradyumna, Samba, everyone were killed in front of him. So his entire creation was destroyed in front of his eyes. But there was a detachment in his system. He didn't feel that, array with so much difficulty, 125 years I lived in this world and did all this and everything got destroyed. No, in fact, that's why yada yada hi dharmasya. He knows that every time he comes to this world, establishes dharma. Even in that establishing dharma, there is a Nishkama Karma Yoga. Because Krishna knows that after some time, this dharma will again come down. So no problem, I'll again come and do my duty. So in this way, Krishna does perfect, Nishkama Karma Yoga behavior, by creating something and at the same time being detached from that. Okay, so just like this example also, if you see Yata Akasha Stito Nityam, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says, just like there is a vessel, right? So I've shown in the slide also, there is a vessel that is upturned. So if there is an upturned vessel, wind blows over it and doesn't go inside. So similarly, in this verse 9.6, Krishna is describing the entire creation as topsy-turvy. He's saying how the rest, everything is resting in the sky, right? So the bottom part of the vessel is at the top. So you can imagine the whole vessel as upside down and the sky is the base, which is Krishna. And everybody is resting in him. So it's a topsy-turvy, upside down vessel. And wind is blowing everywhere, but nothing is going inside. So basically, he remains unattached to whatever is happening. So this is one thing that we learn about Krishna's Nishkama Karma Yoga. How Krishna is perfect example of निष्काम कर्म योग. Another example of how Krishna exhibits Nishkama Karma Yoga is as a teacher. This whole Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is speaking to Arjuna, but still he gives him choice what to do. Right? So that is why in the slide, if you see, I have quoted this Chanakya's verse, where Chanakya says that Lalayat Pancha Varshani Dasha Varshani Praptute Shodashe Varsham Mitra Acharit. So basically, when your child becomes 15, 16 plus, when he becomes 16 year old, at that time he becomes like a friend. Basically, that means that one has to give independence to the children at that age, right? So one cannot, so that is a detached mindset, basically, where you give knowledge, you empower the person and then set them free to do what they want, right? When we say that at 16, the child becomes a friend, what does that mean? What does friendship itself mean? Friendship, in friendship, there is no obsession, right? So when a friend is, so it's like a friend means what? A friend means if he's there, you spend time with him, you laugh with him and all that. And you give him space. You give your friend space and you don't force your opinion on your friend. And a friend is also not very attached to the advice given. You know, there is an affectionate attachment, but there is no obsession. Right. So generally, we become very scared to give freedom to anybody in this world, especially our own dependents. We feel that if we give freedom, they will do mistake. But Krishna's own perspective is not like that. Okay, even if Arjuna doesn't want to fight the war after hearing Gita, so what? So that kind of a thing. So basically, maximum what will happen? He will do a mistake. He will learn over a period of time. So basically, this whole, which Krishna, it's a great treasure, really. I mean, it's something worth learning. How one can be a friend like Krishna, you know, to Arjuna, with our own family members, perhaps with our own children, you know, once they are 16 years plus, where you give them independence and allow them to make choices and don't keep controlling them. So these are some very interesting lessons we learn from this section of Gita 9.6 to 9.10. where Krishna is exhibiting his Nishkama Karma Yoga, right? So this was the second theme that we are seeing for the day. The third one, now if you go ahead in this particular, in this set of verses in Bhagavad Gita, you see that after 9.10, there are a couple of verses where Krishna talks about himself. And they are again certainly very beautiful. Mahatmanastu mam partha devim prakriti mashrita Bhajantya mananya manaso nyatva bhutadi mavyam, that one. And that satatam kirtayanto mam yatantascha dridavrataha namasyantascha mam bhaktya nitya yukta upasate. So basically, these are two verses where he's directly speaking about himself, where he's saying that if someone, you know, chants my glories, worships me with great determination, he's talking about the great souls. So now here, we know how there are so many people who unnecessarily, when they look at these verses, they think that they want to say that this is also Brahman only, right? So just like last time we were speaking about, so there are two things. So if you see in the slide I have just mentioned, so some people, they reject some verses out of stubbornness. They reject some verses out of stubbornness. Stubbornness means like the Maya impersonalist may reject these verses 9.14, saying that no, even though Krishna is saying mom, that mom doesn't refer to Krishna, but it refers to the unborn within Krishna and so on. So some people are very stubborn like that. And sometimes it happens that some people reject some verses out of love. So now if you see 9.15, now what is interesting is immediately after talking about himself in 9.13 and 9.14, Krishna in 9.15 is talking about Jnana Yajnana Chapyane Ajanto Mam Upasate Ekatvena Prithaktvena Bahudha Vishvato Mukam. There again now Krishna has gone back and he's talking about how there are others who worship him as one without a second. Ekatvena, that means in the Brahman platform. Prithaktvena means in terms of different devatas, and Vishvato Mukam means in the universal form. So he's saying that there are people who worship him like this also. And Krishna is counting them as those who worship the Supreme Lord, right? He has not excluded them from that. He's counting them in that. Now, the thing is that sometimes somebody may feel that, so just like I said earlier, that an impersonalist may reject the Bhagavan aspect out of stubbornness. A devotee may reject the Brahman out of love, right? So this can very much happen. And at least from the pure devotee's perspective, it is perfect. It is just like how it's like when a girl falls in love with a boy and she runs away, leaving her parents, right? She rejects everything for that. So similarly, a pure devotee out of love for Krishna, he rejects everything else. So just like we see Madhavendra Puri, there is a very famous verse where he says, Sandhya Vandana Bhadramastu Bhavato Bhosnanatubhyam Namo. He says that nothing I need other than Krishna. He says everything else, I am just offering my obeisances. Mereko kuch bhi nahi chahiye life mein. Right? So because he is in that particular platform of love, so he says like that. Right? Or like we discussed earlier once, how Lord Chaitanya tells the students that I can't teach you anymore. Because I am seeing only Krishna everywhere in Vyakaran. So you please go and learn from someone else. So basically, someone who is at that platform, he doesn't see the need of anything else in this world. He will not see the need of Brahman, of Devatas, right? Like Madhavendra Puri did not see any need for Devatas, or Mahaprabhu did not even see the need for teaching Vyakaran. He said that, I'm totally lost in Krishna. So this is very interesting, because one who reaches that kind of love platform, they kind of become unfunctional in a material sense, because in the material sense, they can't really function. Now, what I really want to say here is that how the avataras, if you see in one way, so if you see, I have titled this particular slide as difference between avatar and paramahamsa. So the difference is that sometimes we see that someone like Madhavendra Puri may become completely dysfunctional in society. But we see an avatar, on the other hand, he is sometimes more real than a paramhamsa. Because like we see Krishna or Lord Rama, when they are in this world, they are constantly ensuring that they're doing all their duties without rejecting anything, right? So whatever their swadharma is, their varna dharma, their kula dharma, everything Krishna or Lord Ramachandra does when they are in this world. They do their sandhya, they do everything. So in some ways, I'm saying that an avatar, if you compare an avatar and a paramahamsa has the liberty to sometimes become dysfunctional in society in a normal fashion. But an avatar never becomes dysfunctional, right? So Krishna, we see in the third chapter of Bhagavad Gita, he has already said that no, I will always continue to do my swadharma properly. Otherwise, people, the whole world will be put to ruination. So if you see in this way, avatar, it's so fascinating. So this is why, if you remember last time, we had discussed this point about how avatar behaves just like a human being, right? And he, because only then he can set an example. Because if he's going to behave like Bhagavan all the time, doing various types of magic, then his swadharma has no meaning most of the time, because he's just doing some things that are not easily understandable. But on the other hand, we see just like Lord Rama also, when Sita was kidnapped, he behaved just like an ordinary human being. He was crying, he was looking at the hills, mountains, crying, lamenting, where is my Sita? Then he makes friendship with Sugriv, walks, crosses the river by making ocean, by making a bridge. And then finally he goes and fights, kills Ravan and brings his wives back. So basically, he behaves, if you see, primarily just like the way humans do, you know, in the normal sense, crying when some relationship is broken and working very hard to get something back in this world. Correct. He doesn't behave like Bhagavan. If he wanted in 1 second, he could have just gone to Lanka and got Sita back. But he doesn't do anything like that. Right. And he doesn't reject the world. He stays there. So in this way, if you compare an avatar and paramahamsa, it is very interesting, because an avatar is so real. And an avatar is always ensuring that he does things in such a way that people can understand, people can relate to him as human beings, right? Whereas sometimes paramahamsas are not like that. Paramahamsas may behave in ways which cannot actually be imitated, whereas an avatar is much more easily understandable. So just like Socrates, I've just quoted him here, he says that don't make your experience or truth into a system, Right. So for example, Madhavendra Puri may have had, so we are just comparing here Madhavendra Puri and Krishna. That's why we put that picture of Madhavendra Puri and Krishna there. So Paramahamsa, like Madhavendra Puri, for him, perhaps nothing else was required in the world, right? He didn't need Varna, he didn't need Kula Dharma, kuch bhi nahi chahiye tha unko. But that experience cannot become a system, because that is the truth at his level, you know, which is not where everyone is. And that's why we see Bhagavad Gita also is talking about, you know, so many other things as well. So for example, Gita, Krishna is talking about Ekatvena, Pratyaktvena, Bahudha, Vishvatomukham and all that. Now the next section of our today's discussion becomes even more interesting. So this is in connection with the next section of the Bhagavad Gita. So I have written here, if you see in the slide, what is Krishna's will and what is Krishna's system? We have titled this section like this because in this particular section of Bhagavad Gita 9.16 to 9.21, Krishna is speaking about the energy, the universal aspect once again, right? Though 9th chapter of Bhagavad Gita is most confidential knowledge, see, so many things come in this. Now, if you look at 9.16 itself, it's such an amazing verse. Krishna is saying, Aham kratur aham yajna swadaham aham aushadam mantroham aham evajyam aham agnir aham hutam. Krishna is saying, what is he? So basically, you know, what I have titled this particular section as is, what is Krishna's will? So many times we have this question, we want to understand what is Krishna's will. So the simple answer is that for normal people like you and me, Krishna's will is nothing but Krishna's system. So Krishna's system as in how he has made this universe to exist, function, and everything, that is only his will. In that only he has put his will, right? In his systems, his will is there. So if you see this 9.16 onwards, if you see these set of verses, they're very interesting. Krishna is saying here, Aham Kratur, I am the Vedic ritual. So that means the yajnas which are there, even Karmakanda rituals which are there, that is actually Kratuhu. Krishna is saying, I am that. Right? Look at that verse. Aham Aushadam. Krishna is saying that I am medicine. Right? Mantroham. I am mantra. Krishna is saying, I am this. So why we are talking about this is because you know, no one can say in this world, for example, if somebody is sick, somebody is not well, then for him, for the sick person, Krishna is there in the healing herb, right? In the healing herb. Aushadam means proper translate that as healing herb. Healing herb means healing medicine. That means for the sick person, Krishna is in the aushad only, right? So, aushade chintayam Vishnu. There is a verse also in Ayurveda which says whenever one takes an aushada, one should remember Vishnu and take. Because that aushada is a representation of Vishnu only. It is coming from him only. Whether it is Ayurveda or whatever it is. So basically all these things are coming from him only in a way. Right. So no one can say that in the name of Krishna, I cannot take treatment seriously. Similarly, if you see in this verse 9.16, Krishna is saying mantroham. I am mantra, Krishna is saying. Now, please note, this mantra refers to, you know, for example, in the context of aushadha, if you see in the Ayurvedic tradition, there is a tradition in Ayurveda where, I mean, it was there, perhaps even now it is there in some places, where the Ayurvedic doctor sees your horoscope also before giving a medicine. So that means he will look at your planetary position. So if you notice, I have put a picture of the 9 planets. So that means the planetary positions in which define at the time of our birth, our daiva, you know, that means our own past, it gives an indication to the doctor as to what kind of person this fellow is or what kind of issues he has. And sometimes it happens that Ayurvedic doctors traditionally were also competent as Jyotisha. That means they were also having knowledge of astrology. And it is said that that would actually help them if they knew Ayurveda and astrology. It is said it was a very good combination. And there are such even traditional practitioners even today, maybe in small numbers in South, where they look at your horoscope as well before giving medicine. So basically, you know, somebody may say that in this horoscope, these Navagrahas are there. Or maybe sometimes the Ayurvedic doctor or the Jyotisha will suggest some mantra. Right. So sometimes it has happened that somebody is mentally, you know, kind of affected. So we have had experience, some devotees, you know, having some very serious problem, let us say mental issues or something, mental health, and they go to an astrologer as part of the treatment. And the astrologer says that, see, this your Chandra Griha or whatever is little weak. And either you'll have to wear this particular stone or you'll have to chant a particular mantra for your mental healing, right? So sometimes when such things an astrologer says, or if a person falls into such a situation, he feels that, is my conviction in holy name compromised when I use these things? So now if you look at these set of verses from Bhagavad Gita, what we understand is this is part of Krishna's system. Krishna has made such a system where our daiva is indicated by these planets, and this aushadha and mantras are all there to cure a person. Correct. So just like you go to a doctor and take a medicine, similarly these mantras also prescribed by an astrologer for a very serious issue in somebody's life is Krishna only. So if somebody takes that as a medicine with this understanding that this is Krishna only, then his conviction as a devotee is not necessarily compromised. It is just like even a devotee can fall sick, right? So he takes medicine. But that doesn't mean that he's thinking that, you know, I should show my faith in Krishna by not taking anything. No, so all this mantra, this aushadha, these rituals, which are sometimes prescribed for such people, are all part of Krishna's system. So that is how we see this. So that is why if you see in this set of slides, I have put a picture of a ritual, the nine planets, Ayurvedic medicine. And also if you see in these set of verses, Krishna says that Pitaham asya jagato mata data pitamaha vedyam pavitra omkara riksama yajurevacha. That I am only the Rig Ved, Sama Ved, Atharva Ved, etc. Correct? So if you remember, we had once discussed before that many times when we hear about Veda, our only verse that comes to our mind is Traigunya Vishya Veda, where Krishna is saying that this three Vedas, which are these Vedas, you're supposed to rise beyond them. But at the same time, we see in this verse, Krishna is saying that he himself is Rig Ved, Yajur Ved, Sama Ved. Correct. So that means in these Vedic mantras, in these yajnas, in these Ayurvedic herbs, everything there is Krishna only. And someone who sees it like that and uses it, you know, he is still considered, he still can be considered a devotee, where his conviction and holy name is not necessarily compromised because he has, you know, gone on to that. Right. So another point here is, so that's why if you see here, I have put up another picture here about Saraswati Thakur inviting that Anderson governor. So why I put this is because when somebody is there in this world, what happens is, you know, as long as you are in the society, you're supposed to interact with the society, right? So why I'm saying this is, if somebody is like Madhavendra Puri, you have given up everything and you are only intoxicated in love of God, then perhaps for such a person, none of this is required. And he doesn't really need it also. But if you are in the society, then you are forced to interact with people. So just like Saraswati Thakur, he had to interact with this person. What is his name? This Anderson, the governor of Bengal. And invite him and give him a position. Correct? So even today we see that anybody who becomes a prime minister or president of the country, since ISKCON, we are an organization in cities and we need government help, we do give them a position and respect them. That doesn't mean we are compromising on our bhakti. Are you getting the point? So just like tomorrow, even if somebody like Rahul Gandhi or Sonia Gandhi, I hope they will not become prime minister, but suppose even somebody from such people, they become prime minister, chief minister or whatever. We see that our devotees, we go to them, we give them a position in some, as a chief guest in some ceremony, you know, because we want their help also sometimes. So even though they're very small, prime minister, chief minister, governor, whatever, we give them position. Similarly, these Navagrahas, these planets or these devatas, these rituals which are there, they may be very small compared to Krishna. That means Krishna is much bigger than all of this. But what we are trying to say is that this is how Krishna has made the system. So if somebody wants to become cured, somebody wants wealth, somebody wants something, there are all these systems in place. And if someone can see Krishna in that system and interact, then that is also considered. So that's why if you see in the Mahabharata itself, after Bhagavad Gita is spoken, we see that how Arjuna, he is worshipping Lord Shiva, Durga, everybody, because he's using all of them and whatever he gets from them in that service to Krishna, right? So he's doing that. Okay. So I said this because this entire series of verses which are there, 9.16 to 9.21, is talking about Krishna's system, right? Krishna is saying that Pitaham asya jagato mata data pitamaha vedyam pavitram omkara rik sama yajurevacha. I am the rik, I am the yaju, I am the sama, everything. Right? So this, I give heat, I send rain. It is actually raining in Pune, by the way. And I am death personified and so on and on. And then finally, this entire section, Krishna ends with this 9.22, which is a very interesting verse, where he says, Ananyas chintayan tomam yejana paryupasate tesham nityabhiyuktanam yogakshemam vahamyaham. He's talking now about those who are in ananya chintanam. That means who are always thinking of him. He says that I will carry what they lack and preserve what they have. He gives that kind of an assurance also. Now again, if you see here carefully, you know, so this verse again, you will have to see in the light of the previous other verses. So Krishna has a system, and at the same time, Krishna says that for those who are completely unalloyed, he would provide and take care, correct? So sometimes you will see like, there is a story of, if you see our Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj, there is a story that how he had a servant whose name was Bihari. And this Bihari became very sick, it seems, once with high fever. And Jagannath Das Babaji, it seems, he spent a lot of time, 3 or 4 hours, chanting the holy name, sitting next to him and touching his chest and rubbing his chest. And it seems in just 3-4 hours, this fellow's fever, everything went away. Correct? So we do hear many such stories. I mean, we have heard about Arjunacharya and or many people where they were ananya chintan. They were always thinking of him. So Krishna only comes home and supplies all the provisions to his wife. And Krishna and Balram, we know that story. Krishna and Balram come with all the provisions and give his wife and say that, see, your husband, he actually beat me. You know, because that Arjunacharya, when he was writing a commentary on this verse, Vahamyaham, he cut Vahamyaham. He thought that Krishna doesn't personally supply. He will supply through someone else. So he cut the verse. So Krishna and Balram come and show that your husband has beaten us on our back and so on. So I'm sure we have heard these stories. So along with these stories, we need to see the previous verses also, 9.16 to 9.21 about Krishna's system. Right? Because for most perhaps ordinary people or ordinary souls who are sadhakas or whatever, right, they may at some time in their life, if required, they may need to go to some such astrologer, come Ayurvedic doctor, come whatever, to solve their physical and mental problems. And even if they have to go, that should not be seen contrary to bhakti, because they understand that no, they are at a different level of reality. We are not a level of reality where we could expect that perhaps. It's not that we don't have faith in the holy name, but we couldn't chant like Jagannath Das Babaji and cure ourselves of the fever. You need to take that medicine. You need to do something, you know, because that is Krishna's system. So that's why I've labeled this whole topic as what is Krishna's will and what is his system, right? So his system is also part of his will only, and that is not to be seen contrary to it. So even if somebody has to do something like that to solve their issues, they should not see themselves or see someone else as violating Krishna's system or anything like that, right? So, yeah. So, certainly if somebody could be like Arjunacharya or where Krishna himself, where they depend solely on Krishna for everything and Krishna does that, that is also there. But generally that is considered, Krishna does that kind of very rarely, because Krishna's interference in the prakriti is not much. the system is operating and he will interfere extremely rarely, but he does that also. So that is also there in 9.27, right? Now the next and the last question for the day. So this is again, So this is again a continuation of this series only. If you go ahead in these verses, we come to the, some verses 9.27. So I have titled here, what is Niti Niti? So this is something from our previous discussion. Somebody has asked in our QA session also, somebody had asked this question, what is Niti Niti? What is Vedic, Upanishadic and Puranic idea of Ishwar? So we just briefly discussed that. So, and we will see this 9.27 and 9.29 and conclude today's discussion. So this Niti Niti process, yeah.
The slide, there is a bar provision. Devotees are
asked. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. So basically the Neti Neti process, if you see carefully, this is just like the Vedic process of understanding God is technically called Neti Neti, right? Because in Vedas, the definition begins by what is not God. So I'm given an example here. The example is like construction of a building. So if somebody wants to construct a building, the first thing is to make the foundation for the building. And the foundation begins by understanding what should not be there. So if somebody is in construction, you would know that there are some rules for construction. You can't construct a building on marshy land. You know, the rock should be even under the ground. If there is an uneven rock, then there is a danger. The land should be legal. Paper should not be a problem. So there are many things, Neti Neti. All this should be sorted out. Only on such a place, the foundation can be there. Right? So the Vedas begin like that, Neti Neti. What is not the supreme? And then the Upanishads which are there, they start actually giving a structure to it. Like how sometimes if a building is under construction, you will see that, you know, there is a particular structure that has come up externally. But then if you look at that structure also, it is not very concrete. So it is not very clear what it is going to be. It is going to be a school, it's going to be a hospital, it's going to be a housing colony. Nothing is clear. So similarly, the Upanishads, you know, talk about Purnamidam. They talk about, there is an abstractness in the Upanishadic understanding of God, which can be compared to the structure above the foundation. And the Puranic God who is there, that means the Krishna described in the Puranas, he is that complete personality. It is like the building which is painted and, you know, it is completely ready for people to move in and start living like that. So this is a simple example that tells us, you know, the kind of difference that exists between the Vedic, Upanishadic and Puranic idea. But anyway, in any case, all of them are integrated. So talking about this integration, if you see 9.27 Bhagavad Gita, it's again a very interesting verse where Krishna is saying, Yat karoshi yadashnasi yat juhosi dadasi yat yat tapasyasi kaunteya tat purusham adarpanam. He's talking about the principle of offering. Right, he's talking about offering. Even in the third chapter, Krishna had spoken about offering. He said that one who doesn't offer, 3.11, he says he's eating only sin. Okay, so now if you see again, this offering process is there for all kind of transcendentalists. So just like devotees offer bhoga to the form of the Lord, the jnani who is there, who worships Lord in his awareness, right? In his awareness, there is an offering. So sometimes you may see that the jnani, those who follow jnana marg, before they honor any food, they will chant this verse, Brahma arpanam, Brahma havir, Brahma agno, Brahmana hutam. So basically, there is an awareness that the supreme is there in this food. So that is also considered as offering only, but that is their process of offering, right? So I'm just saying that because just to understand that there are different types of transcendentalists who also offer perhaps slightly differently than the way we do, right? And the karma yogi, he may not offer externally, but he sees Krishna in karma, right? He sees that Krishna is there in every action of his. So ultimately, a devotee basically integrates everything. For him, in the awareness also, the offering is happening and he is offering it to the deity also. So that's kind of at the pinnacle of success or whatever, right? And the final verse that we are looking at is that 9.29 Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna is talking a little bit about Paramatma. This Paramatma feature we are going to mainly discuss next time, so I'm not going to go too much into this. But it's a very interesting verse, Samoham Sarva Bhuteshu Name Dveshostina Priyaha, where Krishna is talking about how he is neutral, right? So this neutrality is amazing because Krishna is not like a spectator in a stadium. So in a cricket stadium, when a spectator is sitting, he's celebrating or he's expressing disappointment. But Krishna is not like that, right? So he is neutrally sitting over there. And is watching what is happening to this particular person, right? So, I think I will stop with this because this Paramatma is a different section only, which we will take next time. So, I'll just briefly recap what we did for the day and maybe take some questions. So, just one second, let me just go over the slides once again. It was actually quite, 1 second. So, let me just go over the 5 topics that we saw today. So the first thing that we saw was the apparent contradiction between 9.4 and 6.30. So we basically discussed themes from 9th chapter of Bhagavad Gita today. So I'm just summarizing everything in 5 minutes. So we said that how in 9th chapter, text 4 and 5, Krishna is basically saying that he is not there in this material energy, right? He's saying, Nachaham Tesh Vavastita, I'm not there here. But then we said that how in 6.30, Krishna had said, that see me everywhere. Yomam Pashyati Sarvatra. So somebody may say, how can we see him everywhere if he is not there? So what we understand is that in the Purusha form, that means as personality, he is not there everywhere. But as quality, he is there everywhere. Right? And I was giving an example, just like somebody in our tradition, we say the wife is like Lakshmi. But doesn't mean that she is actually Lakshmi Devi. What it means is she represents the qualities of that. And if somebody is able to connect that to Lakshmi's qualities, one progresses. So basically, there is an Achintya Bheda Veda here, right? That is the first thing that we discussed. The second thing we saw from 9.6 Bhagavad Gita is how Krishna does Nishkama Karma Yoga. Because generally in this world, whenever we create anything, we get very attached to it. But Krishna has made such a beautiful big creation, but he is not attached to it. Krishna very clearly says in 9.9 Bhagavad Gita that I am neutral, I am not attached to anything. And we see Krishna actually behaved like that also when he comes to this world. I said that how Krishna, when all his sons die in his presence, his whole family is destroyed, his whole Dwaraka, the city he made, is drowned in the ocean. Right? All this Krishna is witnessing, but he's not affected. It's actually very difficult that when you see your whole construction, whatever you did, everything is destroyed. But still, he's not. So similarly, Krishna establishes dharma, but still it gets destroyed. Again, he comes and re-establishes. So Krishna is actually practicing Nishkama Karma Yoga and is teaching us to do the same. So I was giving an example how Krishna practices Nishkama Karma Yoga with Arjuna also. That how with Arjuna, he tells him Bhagavad Gita and he says, you're free to do whatever you want. And I was saying that how with our children also, when they are 16 years old, one is supposed to give them that independence and behave with them like a friend and not control their career, their marriage choice, whatever, because there is a kind of a friendship relationship over there. Right. So this is the second theme that we discussed. The third theme we discussed was about the difference between avatar and paramahamsa. We said how there are sections in Bhagavad Gita like 9.15 where Krishna is talking about how he exists as Brahman, how people worship him as Brahman. People worship him in the form of various devatas and all that Krishna is counting as worship of himself. Correct. So when we were discussing these verses, we say that how sometimes Mayavadis may or impersonalists may reject the verses like 9.14 where Krishna is talking about himself by saying that this is not Krishna but an unborn within Krishna out of stubbornness. So I was saying out of love, sometimes a pure devotee doesn't give importance to anything else other than the person in Krishna. So we gave the example of Madhavendra Puri who says that I don't care for any ritual, nothing. I don't want anything except remembering Krishna. He says like that, the very famous verse. So we said that how avatar on the other hand is more real than a paramahamsa, as in an avatar. Whenever Krishna or Rama comes to this world, they behave like humans. They do everything that a human is supposed to do to set an example very carefully. So we said this is one difference between an avatar and paramahamsa. Another point we discussed was Krishna's will and Krishna's system. We discussed from 9.16 to 9.21 Bhagavad Gita, where there were several verses where we saw about how Krishna is saying that he is mantra, he is aushadha, he is the ritual and so on. So I was saying how if somebody gets sick, one cannot expect that Krishna will automatically cure him. It may happen, just like it happened with some people in the past, but that is not the process. Krishna's system is that he has given all these things, mantra, aushadha, everything he has given. And he says that you have to take shelter of that at that point of time. And when you take shelter of that, look at me in that. That is the basic point. When Krishna is saying mantroham aham evagyam, that means you take the medicine, you take the mantra, or you take whatever, you wear a ring according to whatever your astrologer told you, but then you still see Krishna in that, right? And that is the system, and which is the perfect way of looking at it. So I was giving an example that how, what to speak of these devatas and these navagrahas. Even in our ISKCON cities, whoever is the chief minister, prime minister, we give them importance, we give them a position. You don't neglect them. So similarly, these people are also to be taken care like that. That's the next point that I mentioned. And the last point we discussed about 9.27 Bhagavad Gita, the offering process of all yogis, and also how the Niti Niti process basically is trying to understand what is the foundation, and Upanishad is trying to give a structure, and finally Puranas are giving an understanding about God. Right. So this is where we are. So if there are any questions, we can take. Otherwise, yeah. Okay, so Damodar Ashtakam Prabhu has a question. Please go ahead.
Yes, Prabhuji. This Neti Neti only I am still trying to understand. And you had given a reference of device also that we do this thing. Trying to understand the personality or the absolute truth by understanding what it is not. So, can you elaborate on this? Like, my doubt is whatever we discussed now, we also know that Krishna is in everything as a quality.
Yeah.
Maybe Brahman or whatever it is. But that is also his part of his personality only. No? So how can we say that what he is not? How can we understand? Are we talking only about Purusha, that is Bhagavan aspect? Or I mean, how do we understand?
Good question. Yeah. Okay, see, first of all, if you see the Bhagavad Gita itself, that doesn't talk about the Neti Neti process. Because the reason is the Itihasas like Mahabharat, Bhagavad Gita, the Puranas like Bhagavatam, they primarily don't talk so much about Neti Neti because they directly give an understanding of who Bhagavan is. Okay, so that is the first thing. So if you see the Bhagavad Gita also, it is talking about Brahma Stita. It is talking in second chapter, fifth chapter. What? But Bhagavad Gita nowhere is saying that everybody should do that process to understand. That is the first thing. Second thing, if you see, now coming back to your question, very interesting question. If God is there in everything, then what is the meaning of Niti Niti? Because har ek cheez mein Bhagwan hai, then how do you understand? See, so if you see carefully, na, there is a very subtle difference between matter and spirit. You know, because spirit is again there everywhere, right? Like we say that spirit is all pervading and Krishna is also all pervading in every atom, everything. But at the same time, there is matter also, right? Are you understanding? There is matter also. That means in the matter, Krishna is there. But the question is, ordinarily, when one interacts with matter, then that is matter only, right? So that is why 9.4 Bhagavad Gita is also important. Because in 6.30, Krishna is saying that, look at me everywhere. But in 9.4, he's saying that I'm not in this. That means basically that he has a separate existence also. And what is there in all these inequalities? So for example, when Krishna says in 10th chapter that among all the animals, I am the lion. It doesn't mean that the lion is literally Krishna. What it means is that there is a magnificence in a lion, right? I mean, I'm sure when we go to the zoo, the most important animal that everyone likes to see is the lion or the tiger. You know, they are really magnificent. And that magnificence is the representation of Krishna. So there you are seeing Krishna with knowledge. You are connecting it with knowledge. You are seeing that magnificence has been given to this animal by the grace of God. And you are looking at it like that. Otherwise, what is there is pure matter only in one sense. Are you getting the point? So that Neti Neti process is not what we are following or what is Bhagavad Gita talks about.
Neti Neti is a Vedic process for the pure jnanis, jnanamargi people. You know, who don't want to take the Puranas and directly understand that. They want to climb the ladder by themselves. So like they try to understand what is the difference between matter and spirit. Like our jnanis and all, if you see also, they... Yeah, I mean, that's in the Western context. But yeah, in Indian context also, jnanis are there. Na? That means the Brahman realized souls. You know, they adopt that process to come to an understanding of what is spirit. But that as a process is not for all of us, because it's not recommended in the Gita anyway. Because the Gita directly gives Krishna, right? I mean, as in it doesn't. That is very clear. Okay?
And Prabhuji, this 3.17, like last meeting we were discussing about, it says that there is no work assigned to the person who is self-realized. But still he works. Haribun?
Yeah.
So what is the purpose of that verse quoting? Like what we discuss is that even if somebody has attained self-realization, he still has to work. So that 3.17 verse, what was the purpose of stating that verse?
Krishna is saying that because he wants to tell Arjun, I mean, at least contextually in the Gita perspective, you see that even if Arjun thinks he is above everything, even still he will have to do the duty of fighting, to set an example. That is the first thing. Because Gita is all from an example perspective, right? So that is why Krishna is saying like that. And also Krishna is very quickly giving the example of Janak, right? In 3.21 or wherever. Where he's saying that, yeah, Janak as an example of self-realized. And it's very interesting because Janak is the only person in Bhagavad Gita Krishna is taking by name and saying. Right? I mean, there is nobody else whom Krishna is taking name and saying, iski tarah bano. Janak is the only person he has taken. Right? Because Janak was that kind of a personality. Because that's what Krishna wants to expect from Bhagavad Gita perspective. Right? But at the same time, I think we discussed today, right? There are people like Madhavendra Puri or Parabhamsa level, they don't do that. That doesn't mean that Krishna doesn't like them or anything. It is just that they are operating at a completely different platform. Yeah, but the Bhagavad Gita is not talking about that. Right? I mean, for more ordinary people like you and me, it is the Gita that becomes more relevant in that context.
And Prabhuji, this question and answer, did not wanted to, they took it in that way. I just wanted a clarification that Bhishma Pitam, and I forgot that it was a folktale. But what is the
it was a
folktale
and also Bhishma himself says it, na, Prabhuji.
Says it. Nobody is pointing it.
Nobody is saying that.
Yeah, but what is the reason Kunti staying with Vidura's house when the Pandavas go to Kandavaprastha?
Kandavaprastha, no. When they go to the Vanvas, you're talking 12 years.
Vanvas, and also she doesn't go, I think, to Kandavaprastha, no? I mean, they are...
No. That is in the Star Plus Mahabharata. In the Star Plus Mahabharata, they have shown like that she doesn't go. So sometimes what happens is that our understanding of Mahabharata is mixed up with the Star Plus Mahabharata. So Star Plus, mein waisa dikhate ki, she is staying here only. But no, that is not the point. But forest, yeah, certainly. I mean, why should she go 12 years in the forest? I mean, she's very elderly in age at that day. So she's staying with Vidura. I think that's perfectly fine. Vidura is the brother-in-law only, na? Family relationship, na? But Pandu, Dhritarashtra and Vidura are all brothers only in a way. So basically, why not? I mean, why can't she... Yeah, I mean, right? That Vyasa is Ambika, Ambalika or Uska servant. Usi context mein aate na, teeno. Vyasdev only impregnates. Na? Vyasdev is the father, biological father of all three of them. Correct or no? So basically, brother-in-law hai. Unke ghar mein kyun nahi ruk sakte? Wo kaha jayegi?
But in the question only he might have is that Vidura was getting also his support from Hastinapur Kingdom.
Hastinapur only.
I got it. But the difference is, Prabhuji, Vidura did everything that he could do to stop. See, Vidura is different in a sense. Vidura voiced openly that what is going on is not correct. Vidura is the only person who is very, very frank with Dhritarashtra. Right from beginning. Pahile Duryodhan paida hua tabhi bola isko maar do. Correct. If you see Vidura, when Duryodhan was born, Vidura says that kill this fellow immediately. Right. So right from the beginning, Vidura is very, very frank with Dhritarashtra about everything. So he has no matlab kya bolega matlab unka koi galti hi nahi tha in that context. And see, basically, please remember, he was an advisor. He was not a Kshatriya fighter. See, there is a difference between Bhishma and Vidura, right? Bhishma is the commander-in-chief of their army. And he's the... Yeah, so basically, Duryodhan did so many things thinking that Bhishma is there to protect me. But he knew all... Duryodhan every time knew that Vidura is not my man. Wo mera kuch nahi karne wala. Hamesha mere ko laat mar. Matlab, you understood, right? So, there is a difference. So, though Vidura also ate the grains of Hastinapur, but he was, blasting openly left, right, center, right? But Bhishma perhaps did not do that much. I mean, relatively, if you compare it like that. Makes sense, na? Samajh gaye ki nahi? Difference hai na? Yes, unhone unka dharma kiya na? Vidura, I mean, at the end of the day, Vidura can sit back and sleep thinking that I didn't do anything wrong. I mean, always I raised the voice. I said everything. Mm-hmm. And that is what was there in my control. I couldn't fight. Mm-hmm. I mean, Vidura was not a Kshatriya, like, he will take weapon and start fighting. But whatever he could do, he did. But the thing with Bhishma, at least in the story, is that he didn't do enough. As in, he could have done a little bit more from saving Draupadi and all. You know, I mean, from that perspective, right? Or Bhishma divided the kingdom. Na, umalam, you know, story. When the Pandavas come back with Draupadi, it is Bhishma who suggests that dono kingdom divide karenge aur isko ek de denge karke. That is Bhishma's suggestion. That is not Vidura's suggestion. So basically that suggestion or, you know, those kind of things are what is the debate. Are you getting it? Na?
Matlab, yes, sir. Proji, on neti neti mein device mein hum log kuch karte hain, aise aapne bola tha. So,
when you preach to new people, we try to tell them na, between what is matter, what is spirit. Correct?
Okay, okay,
in a sense that we say that, like if you see
okay,
that,
what is
like
some soul and,
videos.
In the beginning.
Body, yeah, we do that, right? We show those videos also na, when the body is changing. We say that every cell is replaced in 7 years. So this is not spirit. So like that, you try to come to an understanding of what is the spirit, your essence. In 7 years, all the cells of your body are replaced. So what are we trying to say? Basically, we are trying to say that you're not the body. You're not this. You're not this. You're not this. You're trying to understand what you are. Like that.
Correct? But that is given in Bhagavad Gita also. No? We see like for the shloka, first shloka, it starts with that only. Natvevam. So in a sense...
it is there, but that is always exactly, there. As a logic, it is presented. Mm-hmm. But that is not considered the only way to reach the absolute. Comes to the point. Na? It comes to the point of who Krishna is. Yeah, mm-hmm. Many things come up, right? So it's not that you're relying only on that process to achieve the absolute. It is used as a tool, as a logic to explain things.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Who's Akshay Rao? I mean, is there somebody here?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. I'm Deenubandhu Chaitanya Das here. Just.
Oh, your name has changed, huh? Okay. Maybe someone else's fault.
No.
I was wondering who's Akshay Rao? Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, my another phone, Prabhuji.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah. So, Prabhuji, I like the point of you made about, you know, Krishna's complete... detachment from his creation so that Bhagavad Gita 9.6 to 10, I think, if I remember correctly. So, on one hand, we see Krishna is, of course, very detached from his creation. Even when Gandhari cursed him, he just didn't, he just smiled and took the curse. And he saw his, as Govind Prabhu was saying today also, he saw his all his children dying in front of him. So I mean, that's one side of Krishna we see, but also, sometimes that detachment is misunderstood by people. Like, for example, his detachment from Mother Sita, banishing Mother Sita. Recently we were watching this Ramanand Sagar's Ramayana. So there, they actually show that Sita herself took the decision to go to the forest, and she actually sent messengers, Guptachars to find out that, there is such rumors going on. And I heard the reason is that because even Ramanand Sagar could not accept the fact that Ram could banish Sita. It's just, so many people I've seen even on the internet, they take this, they misunderstand and they, it's highly misunderstood. So how do we understand this like, I mean, particular episode, Prabhuji, I mean, in the context of what, like, the detachment?
Yeah, see, actually, in that context, see, that is for a totally different lesson. Unfortunately, none of these people in the television series are also showing that lesson. But Govind Prabhu always quotes, I think, into some Sri Vaishnava commentary, which talks about this. It says that how, for a king, the public life comes before private life. See, that's the basic theme. That for a king, his public life is considered private life. So, if you see, the story in Ramayana is not that that Dobi who was talking negatively about Sita was only an indication. It indicated that many other people were also talking like that. And Ram understood that I can't function as a king if people are questioning my credibility. See, even in today's world, it is like that, na, Prabhuji. If a public leader's credibility, agar question mein hai, personal credibility, then people don't take him seriously. I mean, even Bill Clinton in America, when he did whatever he did, he had to say sorry, na? Even though America is a very liberal society and people have whatever affairs. But jab Bill Clinton ne affair kiya, usko sorry bolna pada ki nahi White House mein. Because the point is, your private life of a public leader is always questioned. Are you getting the point? So basically, the problem here was that for Lord Ram, his public life as a king was important. So, because that's what he came to do. I mean, Ram has come to do Ram Rajya. And he cannot do Ram Rajya as long as Sita is with him, unfortunately, because people will keep being suspicious. So, he had to forego her. So that was done actually with a heavy heart. If you see the Ramayana, I mean, Lord Ram's life later, you know, he doesn't accept any other wife. I mean, he rules for 11,000 years. And the story is that after killing Ravan and coming back, he enjoyed with Sita for only 2 years. And Sita became pregnant, Lav Kusha were born, and then Sita went back to earth. And Lord Ram stayed alone, ruling the world for 11,000 years. So quite a tapasya, living like a king without a wife. I mean, from a human perspective, if you see. Of course, though eternally, Lord is always connected. So I think this point which is there, na, unfortunately, nobody has understood only that why Lord Ram did that. You're only looking at that private life of that person. In fact, it is a lesson to everybody in the world that if you want to be a politician, your public life is more important than anything else. Otherwise, if private life is so important, don't come into politics, because politics is a public life. That's what they say, right? Are you getting it?
So Prabhuji, actually,
does it mean then that, I mean, Ramarajya, does it mean it's one, it looks like it's an obsession with credibility? I mean, like, you talked about obsession, you know, affectionate attachment. Not obsession, but is it like obsession with credibility in one sense?
Prabhuji, for a public leader, credibility is so important. Without credibility, nobody takes you seriously. You see, na, in today's politics and all, if you see, you know, that political leader ko aajkal Kali Yuga mein bhi kitna important hai credibility hare ke liye. Without credibility, people don't take you seriously. Even today, if it is like that, in Treta Yuga kitna aur hua rahega by credibility. So, credibility of that leader is so important, right? I mean, it's not just another thing. It is such an important facet of life. And, you know, I mean, because Ram came primarily for that. See, Ram ka advent ka kya purpose hai? One is to kill Ravan and another is to set an example of an ideal king, right? And he was an ideal husband. I mean, as in, if you see, Ram is an ideal husband. He worked to get Sita back. And when Sita passed away also, I mean, to Mother Earth, he did not marry for 11,000 years. I mean, he did all the yagyas by installing a deity of Sita next to him. That's the story in Ramayana. That for every yagya, Sita has to be there, na? Wife has to be there. But Ram never remarried. So, he always kept a deity of Sita as a representation of his wife and did all his yagyas. So from that perspective, I mean, as a husband and their personal relationship, that was never affected. Even if you see Sita herself, she also understood her husband's dilemma. Her problem was never with her husband. It was with that separation which somehow happened and that still people were doubting. If you see how Sita goes back to the earth, she tells Mother Earth, you know, when Ram tells that now you come back, she says that she knows that even if I come, still people will keep questioning only. So she tells Mother Earth, if I'm pure, please take me in. And Mother Earth had no other choice. So, she took Sita inside. So, that's how the story ends, right? So, it's not obsession with credibility. We need to understand in that society how important that was. I mean, see, if so you look, like, at them, yeah, as a family, then it becomes a problem. So, that is why some people also say that when Krishna came,
Krishna never took any position. So there is a commentary like this also. That is why when Lord Krishna advents later, Krishna never took any position, because position loge is a problem, a credibility. So Krishna never became king. Krishna had never any issue with his personal credibility, because Krishna had no position only in his life. Please note that. I mean, we call him Dwarkadish, but Ugrasen only was Dwarkadish till end. I mean, he was the king of Dwarka, Ugrasen. Krishna was just a member in the court. Krishna had no position. And that is why he could do what he felt is right, right? I mean, Krishna could marry those 16,000 girls who were in Narakasur's captivity. Krishna could do that. Ram couldn't. See, you have to make that comparison. Krishna could do because there was nothing. Nobody can ask, why is Krishna doing? No, he's just a private individual living in Dwarka. He has no position. Krishna, now please note this carefully. Krishna was not a king. He was just a member of the Dwarka assembly. He was just a citizen over there. Right? I mean, if you see like that. So Krishna married 16,000 girls who were all living in Dwarka. So when we connect all that, then we understand the Lord's psychology, right?
Right, Prabhuji. So Prabhuji, just to clarify, Valmiki Ramayana does not say that Sita herself went to the forest, right? I mean, it's clear that Lord Ram had to banish her, right? Because this
And Sagar shows it. Lakshman only took her. Yeah, that is because unfortunately people question, so people are not ready to understand. So then, see, because Prabhuji, the problem is you don't understand Shastra. We're looking at a TV show, the discussion chahiye, I mean, now as devotees, all of us are devotees for 20-30 years. Still, even now, we are discussing and debating all this. So common man wo bechara TV dekh ke kya samjhega usko, confused ho jayega. So that is why they do all that, right? I mean, they are not at fault.
Prabhuji, this Lavkush also can be considered in a way extension of Mother Sita's thing only. No? So how can we say that they were accepted and Mother Sita was not accepted?
No, come on. Lavkush are Ram's sons. Na? There was never a question about them. See, come on. Sita came back from... See, what is Ram's life also? If you see, 16 years he was married. At 14 or something, he got married. Till 28, he was in Ayodhya. 28, he went to the forest for 14 years. Came back 42. Mm-hmm. At the age of 42, he came back and he became the king. And 2 years, Ram and Sita lived in Ayodhya. And then only she became pregnant.
No, that is fine. That, I am not questioning, but...
So, Lavkush ke upar koi yehi nahi tha. Are, they are Sita's children.
I am not doubt. I mean, that is not I am talking about. Yeah. But Mother Sita gave this fire, entering into fire, that taste also in Lanka. So the Mother Sita, they had a problem with Mother Sita only, no?
Yeah.
So, whatever is in connection with her, that also means that way, I'm trying to say.
No, not necessary. But the children are Rams also, right? And in that sense, So that was never an issue.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Okay.
Prabhuji, I had questions. I mean, about your last week's presentation. I'm not sure if now is a good time to ask, or
I'll just finish the other two and maybe we come back.
Okay.
Nitin Sharma, you have a question? I think he's not there, or I'm not audible. I don't know. Nitin Sharma, aapne hi? Theek hai. Gaurav Prabhu, you have a question?
Prabhuji,
Okay, Nitin has come. 1 second, Gaurav Prabhu, just 1 second pause. Yeah, Nitin, go ahead.
Can I ask Prabhu?
Haan, puchho.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Prabhuji, जो मैंने पिछली बार दंडवत जो मैंने क्वेश्चन पूछा था इंटीग्रेशन जैसे आपने योगा का बताया था कर्मयोग ज्ञान योग भक्ति योग एक साथ कॉन्शियसनेस में रखने के लिए तो ये ब्राह्मण टीचर परमात्मा टीचर और भगवान टीचर तीनों एक साथ ही हम लोगों को कॉन्शियसनेस में रखनी चाहिए
या हाँ अभी देखो अभी परमात्मा के बारे में मैंने बात नहीं किया अभी कैसे को कैसे है ना व्हाट वी आर ट्राइंग टू सेव फ्रॉम भगवद गीता इज दैट ब्रह्मन परमात्मा एंड भगवान देर इज आपका एक मिनट ये करो ना कैन यू म्यूट योर साउंड
ओके
मैं बता दूं या सी बेसिकली वी डिस्कस दिस दैट ब्रह्मन अंडरस्टैंडिंग या ब्रह्मन इज फ्रॉम योर एक्सटर्नल डिस्पोजिशन इन द वर्ल्ड परमात्मा अंडरस्टैंडिंग इज द इनर डिस्पोजिशन We will talk about this next time. वो परमात्मा तो मैं आया नहीं अभी तक
and we have not spoken anything about Paramatma. So there are some more verses and some more themes that we need to cover, 13th chapter, 15th chapter for Paramatma. We'll do that next time. And Bhagavan is about the personal relationship. So basically, that personal relationship with God includes your external and internal disposition in the world. So we are not saying that aapko pehla Brahma Jyoti jaane ka, phir Paramatma realization hone ka, phir hi apne. Wo nahi bol rahe hum log. हमको जो कर रहे हैं हमको वही करना है. वी आर इंटरेस्टेड इन भगवान ओनली, देयर इज नो क्वेश्चन अबाउट इट. बट अलोंग विद आवर वर्शिप ऑफ भगवान, दैट डिस्पोजिशन टुवर्ड्स ब्रह्मन एंड परमात्मा इज आल्सो देयर. सो ब्रह्मन डिस्पोजिशन वी हैव डिस्कस्ड टू सम एक्सटेंट, बट परमात्मा वी आल्सो वी नीड टू डिस्कस लिटिल बिट मोर. सो आई एम नॉट सेइंग दैट वी हैव टू, आप समझ गए ना, मतलब एक चीज है कि उसका डिस्पोजिशन का इंपॉर्टेंस. That is what we are emphasizing upon, because that is there in Bhagavad Gita. Correct. So it is not that one has to have.
Krishna ke system jo aapne bataya ki it is the Krishna system, that I think means, no?
Yeah, it is Krishna system. Yeah, so that's how it is, and that's a complete way of understanding.
Okay. Babaji, one more thing, that as you told that Krishna is the author. About the Ayurvedic medicine and herbs, what you told about astrology is 100%. I have personally gone to Coimbatore and see that certain Ayurvedic centers are having the astrologer and they are doing very nicely. And the point is that it's nice telling that Krishna is the Ayurvedic herb. Is it mentioning only about the Ayurvedic medicine or all the allopathic developments, all the allopathic salts, paracetamol, etc. are also the part of that?
Yeah, see, Prabhuji, see, basically, I would say that, see, allopathy and Ayurveda ka kya difference hai basically? Ayurveda is more like Swadharma and allopathy is more like, you know, Apadharma. Allopathy is Apadharma, right? Abhi kisi ko fracture ho gaya, kisi ko corona ho gaya. So you run to an allopathy doctor only. Not that, you know, allopathy also doesn't have any medicine for corona. But kuch to karenge, ventilator pe dalenge, something they will do. Basically, allopathy is more of Apadharma, emergency dharma. Correct. In a sense, in a larger sense, emergency dharma is also part of Krishna system only. So not that it is not part of Krishna system. See, because even the allopathy medicines that they make, they're making from various compounds which are available in the earth only, right? Maybe their manipulation is very gross, but still it is. So certainly that is also part of Krishna system. At least when you take as a devotee, when you take an allopathic medicine also, you know, from a devotee perspective, it is nice to see that Krishna is there in that also. Yeah, but that's more emergency system. Yeah, that is the point. Ayurvedic system, like I say, aap Ayurvedic doctor, you know better than me. Traditionally, Ayurvedic system, you are supposed to live with the Ayurvedic doctor. Ayurvedic doctor ke yahan aapko jaake rukna padta hai. He will see you. He will keep checking your nadi. He will keep giving some medicines. He will keep seeing your astrology chart. Aise karte rahenge. Aajkal kisko itna time hai? So we just quickly want some medicine and recover and go ahead in life. So we have our own systems in the world. Yeah. Okay, Gaurav Prabhu, you have a question?
Prabhuji, this devta worship and all. So two things over here. One is I was about to share my thoughts, what I have realized and what I've seen in practical life. So even though, like when we say that Krishna is the supreme God and the devtas are anyway serving him, true, but if I look around us, say in office, for example, so many times it so happens that we may have to work with somebody. We want support from somebody from some other team. And even though the person whom we need seeing support from, maybe junior to us, we may ask his manager to help us. But finally, we have to keep the person also happy and satisfied to help us. Otherwise, he will not cooperate. So what I have realized is that same concept we apply to devtas and Krishna also. Even though Krishna, we may worship him and he may sanction things, but devtas also have to be kept happy and satisfied so as to cooperate with us. Is that a fair understanding in practical terms?
Yeah, kind of. So if you remember, I had mentioned this also last, I think 2-3 times back when we were speaking about GEV, right? If you remember, I was telling about how in every vastu, in every village, at least these 5 devatas were there, Lord Ganesh, Devi, you know, that means Durga or any form of Devi, was always very important. Shiva, if you see every holy place, you go to Vrindavan, you go to Mayapur, you will see a temple for Durga Devi, you will see a temple for Lord Shiva, Ganesh ji to rahenge. So basically, you know,
the five important deities who are there, they are always there everywhere and their position is respected. It is not that unke liye you will have to do some too elaborate puja puja and all, but it is just that their position is respected, and just by keeping them in that position, things are also accomplished. That is the point. So if you remember, that is why today also I gave the example of how even tomorrow Rahul Gandhi becomes prime minister, we will call him to our ISKCON temple, na, and give him prasad and give him a garland. Correct. We know that Rahul Gandhi, I mean, hopefully he will not become, but I'm just saying. So, so the point is, even if such a person becomes, we give him a respect, right? I mean, Donald Trump is the president of America. Suppose we come to some ISKCON temple tomorrow, they will receive him very grandly. Usko ek position denge na. We don't say that just because we have accepted Krishna, you are some useless fellow, get lost. Aise to nahi bolte hum log. तो ऐसे छोटे छोटे जो राजा लोग हैं या प्राइम मिनिस्टर चीफ मिनिस्टर उनको पोजीशन जो देते हैं तो दीज नवग्रह दीज देवतास हु आर देयर दे हैव अ पोजीशन एंड दैट पोजीशन कैन नॉट बी कंप्लीटली इग्नोर्ड एंड यू नो रिजेक्टेड आर यू गेटिंग इट सो दैट इज व्हाट इज देयर बेसिकली या बिकॉज दे हैव एज यू आर राइटली सेइंग दे हैव सम स्मॉल फंक्शंस दैट दे डू एंड इवन इफ यू सी फ्रॉम दैट पर्सपेक्टिव अ डिवोटीज मूड इज नॉट दैट कृष्णा ओनली शुड डू एवरीथिंग फॉर मी. Right. So if somebody like that is doing, then that's how the system is. So, right. So Krishna's system includes all these Devi Devatas. So that's how it is. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah. So the next question here is, I think you touched upon this in the previous classes, but I'm not very clear about it, that what is the practical application of this respecting? One is that in your thoughts and mind, you respect them, but externally also, how do you apply this? You observe certain days or you do certain special.
Yeah, I got it. Yeah. Yeah, 2-3 ways, Prabhuji. See, again, now this would come in the domain of Kula Dharma. So basically, according to one's family traditions and everything, you know, certain worship or certain position will be given to devatas. So for example, if you see, I don't know about all communities, but in Brahmin community, for example, any puja that begins, na, it begins with worship of Ganesh. Any puja, you call a priest home to do Shraddha, you call for marriage, Dinabandhu and others also would know this, Chakrapani Krishna. Anything you start, Ganesh Puja se shuru hoga. Are you understanding? That doesn't mean that we have become Ganpati Bhakta now. We are Krishna Bhakta only. But in that puja, Ganesh Ji has been given a position. Are you getting it? Oh, unko ek sthan hai vahan par. Right. So like this, if you see in the traditional Sanatana Dharma way of life, in different times, so if you see the Navaratri festival, if you observe the festivals also now of the Hindu calendar, which generally everybody did all this while, the position to the devatas are kind of automatically given. So it's not that they kind of become the most important Ishta Devata. See, there is a concept of Ishta Devata. Ishta Devata means your worshipable deity. So our worshipable deity as Vaishnavas is always Krishna only. So it's not that. See, there is a difference between giving a position to Ganesh Ji in a ritual and become a Ganpati Bhakta. Are you getting it? Ganpati Bhakta means he doesn't do anything. He doesn't worship only any other Devata. For him, Ganpati only is his Ishta Devata. That means every day, morning, evening, he worships only Ganesh Ji. There are people like that also. Are you getting it? That's not what we are talking about. Are you getting it? So basically, in certain ceremonies, in certain positions, in certain festivals, this day like Lakshmi Puja is there, na Prabhuji. Diwali mein Lakshmi Puja hota hai. So Lakshmi Puja means Lakshmi is given sthan on that day, right? So like that, if you see in the general Hindu calendar or Hindu way of life, these devatas are given a position on certain days or in certain places they are given position. Like any village, if you are there. In every village, Ganesh Ji, Parvati and Shiva, they will always have some deity. Kidhar bhi jao aap. आप मायापुर जाओ, वृंदावन जाओ, उधर भी है दुर्गा भी है, शिवजी भी है, ये लोग सब रहते ही है. सो उनका एक पोजीशन रहता है. सो अगेन, नॉट दैट ऑल ब्रजवासी हैव बिकम शिव भक्त, दे आर कृष्ण भक्त ओनली, बट दे हैव गिवन दैट पोजीशन टू लॉर्ड शिवा, एंड वंस अ वाइल ऑन सम अपीयरेंस डे ऑफ शिवा, दे वुड गो एंड ऑफर ओबेसेंसेस टू हिम एंड चैंट सम ग्लोरीज ऑफ हिज. एंड इन द ब्राह्मिनिकल ट्रेडिशन व्हाट ऑल्सो हैपेंस इज, यू नो, पीपल चैंट वैदिक मंत्रस ना. So in Vedic mantras, what happens is there are many Vedic mantras that address these devatas and they also address Krishna. That means, what shall I say, the Vedic mantras address multiple levels of reality. So like that, there are there actually. So like there are some mantras that at one level address Lord Shiva, another level they address Lord Ramachandra or Narasimha Dev.
So basically, different jatis in India, based on their kula dharma, automatically in their regular way of life, all these devatas would come play some role, and that was never rejected. So even if our Ishta Devata is Krishna and we are worshipping Krishna, still automatically we are given a position to them. Similarly with the Navagraha also. Are you getting it? Like that example I gave today of Ayurveda doctor and Navagraha. So basically, Ayurveda doctor treats you along with your Kundali. So basically, if there is some dosha because of Surya or some Devata like that, he would give some anguti to wear, or you know, like people wear rings na, for to offset a particular or to whatever, right? To appease a particular devata, unka ek sthan diya jata. That again doesn't mean that you have become a Surya Bhakta now. No, again you are Krishna Bhakta only, but that is limited to that functional role, like that. So I think that is a practical application the way we look at it.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah. Haribol, I think who is Smita Nimai Prabhu is there? He's
yes,
Smita Nimai Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhuji. Pranam, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, you mentioned about mantras and mantra also being represented by Supreme, you know, to... So, it's the one of the representations of Supreme. So, that's how we should understand. Prabhuji, generally, there is a saying, right? Samay se pehle and kismat se zyada, and very closely correlated to karma theory, right? That whatever we have done in the past and whatever we are doing now, depending on that, we are sowing the seed and reaping the results. So how, yeah. And we are one side we are saying that Krishna doesn't interfere in the regularly in special circumstances sometimes.
Yeah.
So Prabhuji, how do I understand, right? You know, chanting some mantra is going to improve some situation because some...
Yeah, I got it. Yeah. See, Prabhuji, that is why this is all coming under technically what we call as prayaschitta. See, basically, if somebody is suffering bad health or if somebody is suffering some mental problem, let us say, it is because of some karma, right? And that karma is being governed by some devata also. Are you getting it? So, okay. this astrology science, na, these mantras and these mudras and whatever, they are coming under a section called prayaschitta. Prayaschitta means atonement. Now, actually speaking, now that atonement process, if you see, atonement process is not only doing the external ritual, but it is also that feeling in the heart that, you know, that remorseness, bolte na usko kya bolte, that the feeling, yeah, paschatap, ha, paschatap. So that is the primary thing in atonement, but it is also accompanied by these rituals. See, basically, please understand, karma is a very fluid thing. Karma is not set in stone. Karma is never set in stone. Please understand that. So that means there is nothing like, matlab ye hona hi hai, matlab there is still a fluidity in it. That means it is possible that it could change because based on your prayaschitta, based on what you are doing now, it can change also. So it is never so strongly written in stone like that. Karma is never like that. So you can look at all this as part of the prayaschitta process in general. That is how it is. So basically, you see, now again, generally, if you see, now devotee's mood again, I think Nitin Sharma had asked me that question also on the WhatsApp group. A devotee's mood is not that every day or he's going to an astrologer and, you know, getting his chart checked and doing this homa, that homa. Today is worshipping Surya Dev, tomorrow is worshipping Chandra Dev. So, you know, that. So basically, see, these things are actually generally to be done in case of extreme distress. In case of extreme distress. Now, what is extreme distress? That will have to be defined person to person. Basically, it depends on the tolerance ability. It depends on where he is. Are you getting it? So yes. Basically, let us not see this today's discussion as an excuse that, you know, see, basically, that Vaishnava principle is also there, that as long as you can tolerate something, that's great. I mean, as long as you can see it as Krishna's mercy and that, you know, I deserve worse or whatever, the Bhagavatam verse is there, na? That thank you, Krishna, Brahmaji is telling. So that is fine. If you can live like that, great. But sometimes people cannot live like that. See, that's a practical reality of life. So such people, are they going out of Bhagavad Gita by doing all this? Answer is no. That is also covered. That's what we are saying. See, basically, whole purpose of this discussion is to say that Bhagavad Gita gives you an integrated approach to everything.
So you need not worry about, you know, that anything is outside it. No, you can still, you're still a devotee only. I mean, I recently only I heard at least a couple of devotees. One fellow who continuously suffered financial losses. He was an initiated fellow. So, hamesha, matlab, financial loss. It just became too much for him. Now, again, what is financial loss? Okay, 2 months salary you didn't get now because of corona, then financial loss. But then is that really so much? So, in his case, perhaps it was like that. So, he went to an astrologer and who understood, who was kind of Vaishnava background. So, that fellow gave him a mantra. He told him, do this for 40 days and 40th day, you will get result. This fellow chanted for 40 days, it seems. And exactly after 40 days, he got his first offer. You know, I mean, he got a big business deal on the 41st day. He was very confident that now things are working in my life. Another fellow I heard about, he had mental problem. You know, like mental issues, right? Yeah. So he also took some help of some astrologer and all that. So basically, it depends on, you know, what. So basically, now such a person, are we going to tell them that you are now banished from Bhagavad Gita understanding? You have fallen down as a devotee. You have become a demigod worshipper. No, they are not demigod worshipper. Their Ishta Devata is Krishna only. They are worshipping Krishna only. They are chanting Krishna's name only primarily. Correct. Now, you see, Prabhupada also, Prabhuji, you should read TKG diary. If you read TKG diary, Prabhupada in 1977, 2 months before departing also, Prabhupada would ask Tamal Krishna Maharaj and others to go to some astrologer. At least 2-3 astrologers he sends these people. And some astrologers suggest some ring. And Prabhupada wears that ring also for a long period of time. See, basically, what I'm trying to say is, see, it depends on what problem you're facing and whether that problem is big enough to, you know, do all these things. Are you getting
it? Got it. Like, I got perfect understanding, Prabhuji. Thank you. Prabhuji, one question more. You said that Vedas to Upanishads and then to Puranas, the understanding about the Supreme, you know, gets clearer and clearer. But then, you know, we see that a lot of dispute comes in when people come to Puranas, when Shiv Purana and Vishnu Purana comes in, and then people get obscured in, you know, what clearly is the... And then one of the reason is, as you are saying, right, we have not, like, personally myself, I don't have an understanding of Puranas. So, but generally, if that is being followed, right, so then why this confusion comes that, you know, Shiv Purana is saying this, Vishnu Purana is saying that, although we see that Shiva worshippers also in a way they are, like, we kind of say that, you know, they are kind of in ignorance and all that, but they also get up in the morning at 4 o'clock and they do their sadhana and everything, right? Why this obscurity comes?
Okay, see, two things. See, one is when we say Puranas give the form, that form can be different also. So just like, you know, the building example, is a foundation, there is a construction going on, and then there can be a cinema theater, there can be a temple, there can be a housing complex. What construction is going to come is going to be something different. Okay, yeah. Now if you see Shiva also, if you see Prabhuji, see, the Vedic system is such that, I mean, I'll tell you one thing. There is one quote in Brihad Bhagavatamrita if you read, and I'll substantiate that. Just hold on. So, Brihad Bhagavatamrita in one place, Sanatana Goswami says that if somebody would worship a devata, you know, looking at that devata as the supreme, purely, with pure intention, then through that also he reaches Krishna. Are you getting it? Matlab, kisi ne Shiv Bhakti kiya. Or aisa kiya ki Shiva hi supreme hai aur baki koi galat intention nahi tha. I mean, it's not Ravan or, you know, somebody like that who's worshipping Shiva with ill motive. Barabari Shiva puja kar raha hai. But then Shiva's duty it becomes to ensure that because he's a pure worshipper, he's worshipping me in the mood of unalloyed, unmotivated, uninterrupted Jovi spirit. It becomes Shiva's duty to take him to Krishna. Iske liye story hai Markandeya Rishi ka. You see Markandeya Rishi in our Bhagavatam, na?
Yes, Prabhu.
This Markandeya Rishi is a Krishna Bhakta ultimately, but in his younger age, he was a Shiva Bhakta. So that comes in other Puranas. That till the age of 16, he was a Shiva Bhakta and a very, very pakka devotee of Shiva. And it is said that Shiva protects him from death also at one particular point of time. And ultimately, Shiva gives him the next step that, you know, now you go to Krishna like that. Vaisa dusra Purana mein story hai. So basically, matlab ye jo external form pe bhi agar tum dekhoge na, utna ye bhi nahi hai ki the spirit of worship is more important. How you're worshipping. So that is why in the Vedic process, if somebody is connected to a devata,
एक्सटर्नल फॉर्म, बट अगर उसने वो प्रिंसिपल अपना है ना, भगवत गीता का प्रिंसिपल अहेतु की अप्रतिहता, वैसा अगर वो देवता को अप्रोच किया, वो देवता का प्रॉब्लम है कि अभी इसको भगवान के पास में कैसे भेजू, क्योंकि बिकॉज ही अंडरस्टैंड्स, अरे दिस फेलो इज नॉट लाइक ऑर्डिनरी देवता वर्शिपर, यू नो, हु सिंपली वर्शिपिंग मी जस्ट टू गेट थिंग्स, बट ही हैज अंडरस्टूड. सो दैट्स व्हाई देयर आर डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ देवता वर्शिपर्स. See, there is one devata worshipper like Ravan or Hiranyakashipu,
yes,
who is worshipping just to get material benefits and nothing else. There are worshippers, like I told you, like a devotee also may approach any of these devatas circumstantially. Like Arjuna also worshipped Shiva, right? And he got Pashupatastra. Yes. But Arjuna is not Shiva Bhakta, please note. He worshipped Shiva, iska matlab wo Shiva Bhakta nahi hua. Arjuna is Krishna Bhakta only. But he worshipped him circumstantially for some particular thing. अभी ये चाहिए उसको सेवा के लिए, इसीलिए किया, करेक्ट. एंड द थर्ड थिंग इज somebody like Markandeya who may worship a devata thinking that he is the ultimate. And worship सपने के पास जाते हैं. So my point is things are not that simple as it just seems outside. So basically like that.
Got it, Prabhuji. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Yeah. Dinabandhu Chaitanya Prabhu, I don't know whether he's there. I think he was in some other name.
Yeah. I'm there.
Sorry, Akshay Rao. Akshay Rao. Yeah, go ahead.
My question was, Prabhu, like, I think we discussed this in 2 weeks back, the discussion on Kula Dharma. We were talking about Vanaprastha and how, you know, like you were giving examples of Dhruva Maharaj and Prahlad Maharaj, and you mentioned that, you know, Swadharma itself is perfection and all these people till the very last, they were actually in engaged in their Swadharma. You also mentioned about Bhishma Pitama, that he lived for 350 years, but it was only in the very last that he, you know, completely dedicated himself in that sense. So my point was, when we were talking about Vanaprastha, you said, like, of course, ISKCON temples are not able to support Vanaprasthas, as you gave example of our own temple. We can't take him. But
Are Baba Vanaprastha thodo, there are, I'll tell you, many Western world, even Brahmacharis ISKCON nahi support kar pata. They tell them that you earn money yourself and sustain. Anyway, go ahead. Yeah, what's the question? Sorry, I interrupted you. You were
So Prabhuji, I'm saying, like, but there is still the spirit of Vanaprastha. Like, we see some devotees, like, for example, we have, let's say, Vamshi Gopal Prabhu in Pune, Radhika Mataji, and they go to Kharagpur and they preach, for example. I mean, not that they're staying in the temple.
Got it.
I mean, so, like, you know, doesn't this, I mean, the spirit of
Vanaprastha can be practiced. I agree. So, the spirit of Vanaprastha would be in your own Swadharma mode only. But it will be just that, you know, you reduce social interactions. So that part I agree. I think I said also, I don't know whether I said it. Matlab, you bahut jyada party karna, shaadi mein jana, social festivals mein, you know, kind of spending time in that. So those kind of things should reduce with age. And one does one service nicely. So whatever that service could be. I mean, I don't only want to say that somebody is a preacher. Abhi Vamshi Gopal Prabhu, the example that you gave, they are preaching, right? I mean, they are that kind of a role. But again, everybody may not fit in that role. So that's fine. So basically, yeah. So that part I agree. That reducing social interaction and giving more time to, kind of spiritual activity or social activity in some way is certainly a practical Vanaprastha. Yeah, that part is agreeable. No question about it. But I was only saying that lecture that this whole division now, 25, 25, 25, 25. Like we say, at 50, 75, like that. So in that, I was saying that let's not go too much into that number, right? Because that number may it may not happen. Matlab, at 50, it's not necessary that your daughters will be married or, you know, things should happen by that time. Otherwise, you're still active in society only. You can't say that I'm taking off.
Right, Prabhu. I mean, and the examples you gave, like, for example, I think you mentioned Krishna Chandra Prabhu, like, you know, he's contributing.
His father.
You also mentioned Jaydev Prabhu at the age of 72. So, like, of course, like, the examples you gave were contemporary examples. They were of businessmen or, maybe doctors. They can contribute with their Swadharma till the very last. But you know, for most of us who are working for somebody, or like, I mean, we are just struggling to satisfy somebody else's, whims in our office. So, I mean, I don't know, like, will that apply to us? Like, I mean, so in that case, our Swadharma, fighting our Swadharma, we can't even contribute meaningfully through that means, because, I mean, we are not really earning that much. That we can contribute in that sense.
I agree, but you may have some other talent. Nah? You may be a teacher, for example. You know, maybe you could teach children. I mean, honestly, I'll tell you, there's so many children, and always, not only today, but even 20 years down the line, would need good role models, right? Where somebody is there. Currently, perhaps nobody can teach them because perhaps you don't get enough money in that. Or correct? Nah? So people can look at various ways in contributing. So basically, see, ब्राह्मण क्षत्रिय वैश्य शूद्र उनका कंट्रीब्यूशन अलग रहता है ना. वैश्य बिजनेसमैन है तो उसका कंट्रीब्यूशन पैसा में रहेगा. ब्राह्मण बोल सकता है तो उसका कंट्रीब्यूशन एजुकेशन में रहेगा. करेक्ट. सो दैट एजुकेशन कैन बी एट डिफरेंट लेवल्स आल्सो ना. इट्स नॉट दैट एजुकेशन मतलब यू हैव टू गिव भागवतम क्लास ओनली. दैट इज वन टाइप ऑफ एजुकेशन सर्टेनली. बट इट कुड ऑल्सो बी दैट मे बी यू कैन गेट, आई मीन आई एम जस्ट सेइंग, मे बी समबडी कैन गेट एसोसिएटेड विद सम गुरुकुल और some project where you are able to help some children, why not? So that is also a very good contribution. I mean, if that suits your Swadharma and nature.
Okay. Yes, Prabhu. And Prabhu, last thing, like, this is a little more practical question, which has always bothered me. We talked about Kula Dharma and how it's important to, you said festivals, and two more things, if I remember, I think you talked about language, festivals, and one more thing as the most important part of family, when it comes to festivals, I think all of us will agree that probably cutting across the length and breadth of India, Deepavali is the most important festival, likely for most of us.
Navratri is very important. I would say actually in many ways, Navratri becomes more important than Deepavali, at least across India if you see. At least in South if you see, Prabhuji, Diwali has become recently famous. I mean, as it's that popular, but it was not so much. But Navratri is considered very important. Anyway, go ahead.
Right. Okay. I mean, at least from where I come from in South, it seems like Deepavali is considered almost like a non-negotiable thing that you have to be there at that time.
So what I'm saying
is because, somehow or other, our Kartik Yatra always comes at that time. And, it's a consistent complaint, which we, not only me, but many others have been mentioning that their parents are, so it's like, we can't do that Kula Dharma in that sense. So, I mean, I just want to know, if you counselors or
there have been a discussion with Maharaj also. But what happened was they would never get any other slot, where it can actually happen. Because Diwali time, everybody gets chutti easily. Otherwise, they don't get time actually. So that is how it always lands up there. My suggestion is, many times we are also not able to go for Yatra. Honestly, I'll tell you. It's not that every year, every Grihastha comes for Yatra. Aisa bhi nahi hota. So at least 50% of the time, people are, I'll tell you, this year, I seriously doubt if Yatra will be there. I mean, they have announced that it's going to be in Mayapur, but maybe a corona ka chakkar chal raha hai. I'm skeptical about it. Whether actually Bharaj will take 7,000 people to Mayapur and whether it will happen. Also because kya 2-3 mahina logon ne naukri nahi kiya, ye nahi kiya. There will be a lot of work pressure also for everybody. So nobody is going to get 2 weeks leave during Diwali so easily. Even in college, we are not going to get what to speak of companies and all that. So I think there will be several locations where all this Yatra and all will not be there. But whatever it is, the underlying point is that your children would have to see Deepavali celebrated properly at home. So you will have to adjust. Children's formative years are between 5 and 15. So in those 10, 11 years of their children's life, even if 4-5 times you go for Yatra, 5-6 times you may not go also, right? Due to various complications. So that time at least let them see the Deepavali celebration very nicely. But the underlying theme is that all festivals are very important and as per our tradition. So basically that is non-negotiable. Yeah. Because otherwise what will they practice later? See, try to understand what will your children practice later? See, this corona, one more thing it has taught us that it can happen that abhi dekho na mandir mandir bande sab religious institutions bande humko malum nahi kab khulega government ke priority mein last hai religious institutions because religious institutions mein koi bhi social distancing nahi rehta whether it is a temple, a mosque, or a church, jo bhi hai, right. ISKCON temple also, no social distancing, right? I mean, this is, social distancing is completely absent in a religious institution. So governments all over the world are going to open religious institutions last. I mean, they may open after 1 year. So my point is simple. हमको गृहस्थ लोग को भक्ति घर में बैठ के करना है ना, और हमारे बच्चे जो है पता नहीं वो कहाँ करेंगे, कहाँ रहेंगे, कैसे करेंगे. So unless they see festivals, they see things celebrated at home as per culture, what are they going to do later in life? I mean, as in, what is their identity? So please note that this has long-term implications in terms of that. Yeah, Gaurav, you want to say something?
Probably just one thing. I think, see, this Diwali thing is definitely, you know, becomes as a irritant sometimes for people to take a decision. I think what we can suggest also is that winter vacations that we have in December, January, that is also a good slot for the yatras.
No, arre baba, wo discuss hua that Prabhupada book marathon is there na, that is why wo discuss hua hai. But okay. I mean, that is a managerial issue. Marathon is there na, you are supposed to be distributing books. So that is why it cannot be that time. That is if you remember, okay. 2-3 times Maharaj took yatra in December also. Not that he has not, he has taken 2-3 times. Because of that, yes. That slot gets cancelled. And that is the problem. I mean, I don't want to say problem, but that is the issue here. Anyway, I mean, that's beyond our scope of whatever. Okay, I'll take the last question. I think that is Uddhavanand Prabhu. I don't know.
Yes, Uddhavanand Prabhu.
Last question. Yeah, go ahead. Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Thank you very much, Prabhuji, for wonderful class. Actually, my question is related to one of the answers which you were giving about this Markandeshwar. So actually, this question was asked to me also by one guy and I was actually not able to answer it. So what is this exact story of Markandeshwar? I read it. Markandeya Rishi.
Yeah, see, Markandeya Rishi. Bhagavatam, we know the story. Na? I think it's in 11th canto or 12th canto it comes, where he is, he wants to see the Maya Shakti of the Lord. And then how there is a pralaya. And then finally he sees Krishna on a banyan leaf. And no, no. He goes into Krishna.
I'm not asking from that context. I'm asking from different context because... It appears that he was a very great devotee of Lord Shiva and he was supposed to die at the age of 16. As soon as the Yamdutas came, he chanted the name of Lord Shiva and Lord Shiva protected him. So here I didn't understood, like we have our second offense also against holy name, that one should not consider the names of demigods like Lord Shiva or Lord Brahma to be equal to or independent of names of Lord Vishnu. So now,
where did he consider? So basically,
One minute, Prabhuji. I will just complete my question so that whether it is relevant. So the question is like, now if we see, now Shiva's name also protected, just like Ajamila was protected by chanting the name of Lord Vishnu. So now here, since I am very neophyte devotee, so I am not able to understand that the potency is different. It is written in scriptures, but here for a person like me, it is apparently appearing that it is equal. So how to understand that they are not equal and the name of Lord Vishnu is in, and they are dependent also.
Actually, if you see, na, Shiva and Vishnu, there is so much of non-difference between them.
Yes.
See, the if you see among all devatas, na, Shankar Bhagavan has a very different position only totally. Yes. He is considered, almost at the level of Vishnu only. So in so many ways. So he has the power to deliver people at death, protect them from Yamaraj. Yamaraj is a very tiny demigod in front of Lord Shiva. So basically, and this Markandeya, this story which you are telling, this comes from the Shiva Puran, I think, where this Markandeya Rishi is a great devotee of Shiva and is worshipping Shiva with great faith. And at the age of 16, he is supposed to die. But when Yamaraj comes, he is holding the Shiva Linga worshipping. So Shiva tells Yamaraj that you can't touch this fellow now. So basically what we understand is he had a karma to die. Otherwise, Yamaraj would not have come.
Yes.
But because Lord Shiva was, so pleased with him and Shiva has that potency. Now, please try to understand, there is nothing that he has offended the holy name or something. It is likely in that story of Markandeya that he had no knowledge only about Krishna.
Yes.
Are you getting? He was just a Shiva Bhakta from childhood and he was a very unalloyed, he was worshipping Lord Shiva. Purely he was worshipping. Okay. So basically, Shiva didn't send him to the spiritual world or something. What did he do? He stopped his death. Then onward, Markandeya progresses by the grace of Shiva. Now, I don't know the complete story, but ultimately he becomes a devotee of Krishna only. See, that's what I was telling you, na? I use that example to make that point only. That if you are a pure worshipper of Lord Shiva, koi hai aisa. I mean, we don't have to be like that. But if somebody is like that, then that person is directed by Shiva or to Krishna only, na? So there are all these verses also where it is said that if somebody dies in Kashi, then Shiva will come and whisper the name of Lord Ram in that fellow's ear and so on. So basically, see, Shiva is at a different level only. So basically, he is able to do that, and the Shastra says that. So there is no conflict with that. It is not that by taking Shiva's name, one goes to the spiritual world of Vaikuntha, but one gets liberation, one stops going to Yamaraj, and ultimately Shiva will direct that person to Vishnu. So that's fine. Yes. Perfect.
Yes. Prabhuji,
what is the meaning of independent of the names of the Lord Vishnu? So, is there any correlation between the holy name of Lord Vishnu and Lord Shiva? Or because the offense...
See, basically, the offense in Padma Puran, what it says is that to see these people as, you know, that means, see, this is like, you know, someone who... See, generally, you know how the offense works is you have to have that knowledge also. Okay. So, for example, we see, you know, like we say, sinning on the strength of the holy name. Now, if we say Ajamil was sinning, but he was not sinning on the strength of the holy name.
Yes.
He was sinning, that's all. Oh, holy name ke bal pe paap nahi kar raha tha. Right. So, in these stories, if you see carefully, Abhinnatvam, so basically that means to see that Shiva is an independent person from Krishna. Right? So that becomes the offense. So that means to see that, you know, there is a difference between them. Because there is no difference. They are one also, in a sense. Correct. Are you getting the point now?
No, I didn't got. Look, because the Rudra Tattva is different from Vishnu Tattva. That,
there is a difference. There is a difference, but there is a union also, na, Prabhuji. That's what, na?
Yes.
Veda, Abeda. See, this Veda, Abeda, you'll have to apply everywhere.
Okay.
Veda, Abeda, you'll have to apply. Are Baba. जीव और भगवान में भेद अभेद है तो भगवान शंकर और उनमें तो बहुत कम भेद अभेद है ना मतलब सिमिलैरिटीज आल्सो मोर ना प्रभु जी वो है ना 56 और 60 क्वालिटीज 56 क्वालिटीज आई थिंक आर देयर इन शिवा व्हिच इज यू नो अ लिविंग बीइंग कैन गेट ओनली 50 सो देयर इज अ मच मोर क्लोजनेस ओवर देयर सो बेसिकली या मच मोर क्लोजनेस इज इन दैट एट दैट लेवल सो दे हैव दैट सो दैट पावर इज इन्वेस्टेड विद देम एंड So one should not be surprised that Shiva has the ability to do things like this with his devotees.
Yes. This point I got. But the point which is not clear to me is what is the meaning of independent of the names? There is a statement. So
that means if you think that he is completely independent, that means इसको कुछ लेना देना नहीं उनके सर. मतलब तुमने अगर तोड़ दिया कि मतलब कृष्ण अलग है और भोलेनाथ अलग है शिवा अलग है ये कोई अलग ही है that you can't do. Yeah.
Okay.
They are neither same nor independent, right? Obeda, abeda. Matlab, dono hai. Matlab, you can't. Yeah, like that. Yeah.
Okay. This is little difficult for me to understand, actually.
Yeah.
Prabhuji, one comment here.
Thank you.
That Daksha Prajapati all time also, right? He disregards Lord Shiva. And at that time, Veerbhadra is sent. So I think that also explains that this Veda Ved much that they are kind of similar because Lord Vishnu kind of steps back to protect him in completely.
Oh yeah, sure. Yeah. Shiva is considered different. Yeah, certainly. I mean, if you see Sanatan Goswami, what a relationship he had with Shiva. He was staying in Chakleshwar Mahadev temple. Sanatan Goswami in Vrindavan, he was staying in the temple of Lord Shiva. I mean, it's quite revolutionary. If today some sannyasi in ISKCON or someone says that I am going to stay in a Shiva temple and do my tapasya, somebody will say, kya, wahan kyun reh rahe ho yaar? Sanatan Goswami was staying there, right? He was staying in Chakleshwar Mahadev temple in Gowarda. And when he was going to leave because mosquitoes were biting, Shiva told the Devata of mosquito that don't trouble him. I want him next to me. So basically, I mean, sometimes, you know, we have a very, you know, actually we have a more bhinna understanding. Right. So the understanding of that oneness is not so much there with us. Sanatan Goswami reconciled. He was peacefully staying there.
Yes, Prabhuji. And Prabhuji, in that Markandeya also, like, I usually have that difficulty perceiving how everything, like, how these, because you mentioned somewhere that Shiva is compared somewhere to demigods, but he's how do we understand that, how he is abhinna or he is different than demigods?
No. So that is very clear, na, Prabhuji. Nectar of devotion mein bhi aate hai na, ki the living entity till Brahma can have only 50 qualities.
Yes.
Shiva has 55, Narayan has 60, only Krishna has 64. So Shiva is above all demigods, including Brahma. Oh, alag position hi hai na unka.
Okay, Prabhuji.
Yeah. Okay, I think there is some last question of Rupa Gaur Prabhu. Maybe this is a real last. Yeah, go ahead. Are you there?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yeah, go ahead.
Hare Krishna.
Yeah, Hare Bol. Please,
Prabhuji. See, I'm always, sort of uncomfortable when I was always uncomfortable hearing this pastime of Tirumal Shai Alwar, when Lord Shiva and Mother Parvati were going and saw Tirumal Shai Alwar, and they asked, Lord Shiva for the benediction. And Tirumal Shai Alwar said that, I don't want anything. But when Lord Shiva insisted, he said that, okay, can you give me liberation? So he said, no, I cannot give liberation. Only Narayan can give liberation. Then second thing, Tirumal Shai Alwar says that, okay, then increase my lifespan by one moment. And Lord Shiva said that, I cannot do that. So then he said that, okay, then he said something which Lord Shiva became angry, and, there was a small confrontation. I mean, I heard this in the lecture of Bhakti Samad Maharaj long time back. So how is it, Lord Shiva is saying that I cannot give liberation, and while he is giving liberation to many people, and he also says that I cannot increase the lifespan by one moment. I mean, this thing I was never
able to. Yeah, I can't say anything. I'll have to go into that story. I don't remember. I remember very faintly hearing the story, but I'll have to go again once and see. Sometimes, some things are said as a matter of mood, not literally. आप समझ रहे हो ना? बहुत बार ऐसा होता है हमारे stories में. कुछ चीजें बहुत literally नहीं लेना चाहिए. मतलब वो लीला में क्यों बोला? उसके लिए दूसरा ही कारण रहता है बहुत बार. Because literally, it is certainly not so. Shiva has the power to do all that. So
yeah.
So literally, अरे Shiva छोड़ो, Yamaraj can extend your life, Baba. वो सत्यवान सावित्री का स्टोरी में है ना, वो सावित्री सत्यवान के पीछे पीछे जाती है और यमराज को बोलती है मेरा पति वापस दे दो, दे देते हैं, एक्सटेंड कर देते हैं उसका लाइफ. सो बेसिकली यमराज के अंडर शिवा इज मच मोर स्ट्रॉन्गर. सो व्हाई दे आर सेइंग इन दैट स्टोरी वुड हैव टू बी सीन. मे बी दैट इज स्पेसिफिक टू दैट कॉन्टेक्स्ट फॉर अ पर्टिकुलर पास्ट टाइम. दैट कांट बी टेकन एज अ रियल स्टेटमेंट. आप समझ रहे हो ना मतलब वैसे.
प्रभु जी प्लीज फॉरगिव मी, वन मोर क्वेश्चन एक्चुअली आई हैव. So basically, I am very weak in this understanding the concept of Achintya Bheda Bheda Tattva. And one doubt which I have is like the 64 qualities of Krishna and 60 qualities of Lord Vishnu and 55 qualities of Lord Shiva which are mentioned. And the Jiva cannot have more than some 30 qualities like that. It is mentioned in Nectar of Devotion. So now there are two philosophies which my understanding is. One is that the Jiva is qualitatively same with the super soul, but quantitatively it is different. So when this comes, Prabhupada most of the time he mentions about Sat-Chit Ananda aspect. But Rup Goswami is explaining now these 64 qualities also. So why these are not considered into taking consideration? Because if these are taken into consideration, then even qualitatively also Jiva cannot be equivalent to the super soul, because it can have only 30 maximum qualities, right? As per the Nectar of
Jiva. No, 50, 50, 50.
No, 50 is for Lord Shiva.
No, 55 for is Brahma, for Shiva. Okay. One second. Brahma is like a living entity only, like you and me only. Yes, for all living entities, till Brahma it is 50, Shiva is 55, Narayan is 60, Vishnu is 64, Krishna is 64.
Okay, accepted. So
oneness is there, na? 50 bhi bahut hai na, baba. 64 mein 50 bhi bahut ho gaya. Isse kuch kam nahi hai 50.
Qualitatively also we are inferior there.
Yeah, so in that also there is a achintya bheda bheda, na? So there is a same oneness and difference. So it's, see, don't take it like this that quality mein we are same and in quantity we are completely different. No, it's not like that. Qualitatively also there can be a difference, na? And quantitatively also there can be a similarity, mind you. Just like Narad Muni, if you see in Brihadvagatamrita, he tells Gopakumar that by the mercy of Krishna,
He says that me, Hanuman, Garuda, all of us, we expand ourselves. And we are there simultaneously in many planets at the same time. Are you understanding? Okay. So sometimes even a Jiva has given that power to be there in many places. Are you getting it? So even quantitatively, uska matlab jo expansion shakti hai na, wo badh jata hai, wo Bhagwan ki mercy se badhta hai. So usme bhi similarity ho jata hai fir Bhagwan ke saath. So it's like that. So I think that quality quantity don't go very binary. That quality is the equality and quantity is the difference.
Okay.
Quality may be difference hai na. That is accepted.
Okay, so what does this quality means actually? The quality means these 64 qualities which are mentioned in Nectar of Devotion.
Yeah. So that is one part of it. And also the Satchidananda, eternity, eternal, na? Quality mein wohi aata hai na?
No, I didn't got this point.
Eternity. Hum log eternally hai na? Bhagwan eternally, Bhagwan humko banate nahi hai na? We are not created by God, right? You're co-eternal with God. So all that.
Okay.
Okay. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much.
Yes, Prabhupada.
Shila Prabhupada ki jai. Thank you very much. Haribol.